What manner of love the Father has lavished upon us that we should be called children of God. Let's celebrate that this morning.
Walking the wayside, lost on a lonely road, and I was chasing the highlight, trying to satisfy my soul, and all the lies I believed in left me crying like the rain. Then I saw lightning from heaven, and I've never been the same.
I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found the word of freedom, I found a friend of Jesus. I am a child of love. I
felt the sting of the fire, but I saw you in the place. Just when I thought it was over, you broke me out of the grave.
I'm gonna climb the mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found the world of freedom, I found a friend of Jesus. I am a child of love.
Holy are you, Lord. To come up front real quick for me. The kids would like to come up front, come up front. This is our family Sunday, so we are going to have a chat real quick. Y'all go ahead and take a seat. Take a seat. So as Kier's coming up here, did y'all bring Stump Pastor James items? Anybody? Mia, you did? All right, Mia, let's see what you got for us. It's a pen. Okay. This is going to be a good one. So, again, for those of you that don't know what Stump Pastor James is, again, it's kind of like Brown Bag Sunday, if y'all remember that. The kids bring an item. I have no clue what the item is beforehand. And on the spot, I have to come up with a little devotional. And I'll say, this is going to be a tough one. A pen. It is. It is. Kier, you can try. I'm not just a pretty face, Kier. I got a mind, too.
Did you find one of the marker we had?
No, that was the other one that she did.
Yeah.
I did. That one was about everybody having talents and using your talents.
That's basically a marker.
Well, it's a pen. Pen is a different than markers. Anyway, all right, so the pen. So when I think pen, I think writing. All right, do y'all write with pens in school, or are you still with pencil? Pencils. So I used to use pens all the time when I was in school. And sometimes if you write and you smudge a little bit, right, and then you get the ink on your hands, and then you, like, wipe your face, and you have a big ink smudge on your face, and it's no good, and you put it on your clothes, ruin your clothes, leave it in your pocket, right, and you get your clothes washed, now you have a huge ink stain. It's a lot of fun. But when I think pens, I think writing, right? And what is special about writing? So you can write the books of the Bible, right? We talked about Moses, right? We've been talking about Moses.
Oh, yeah.
Remember what was written and given to Moses?
Oh, yeah, the Ten Commandments on two separate stone tablets.
Yes, sir. So the Ten Commandments were also written and given to Moses. So when I think writing, I think about the things that were written and that were given to us from God, right? So we have the Ten Commandments, right? We have the whole Bible, right? And some people have even written books and stuff to help us understand all that stuff a little bit better, right? So I think it's important, right? When we have our pens, we write stuff, right? It's important to remember where all that stuff comes from. The wisdom that is given to us by God through others helps us along the way, right? So as y'all get older, right, congregation, as you do your own private devotionals and stuff like that, use the stuff that people have written, right? Use that to help you in your faith. Use that to help give you a better understanding of God, right? All that stuff is going to help push us in a closer relationship to God. So here's your pin back. Good job, guys. Try again next time. Okay? I like it. Good job. Good job. Good job. All right, y'all can go take a seat. Here's your pin back. All right, y'all can get back to your seat.
Okay.
Good job, guys. So, as we continue forward with our service this morning, I'd like to say a very special welcome to all of our visitors that are here with us in person, as well as the ones that are joining us online. We don't ask that you do anything special, but on your bulletin that you were given, there's a tear-off section. If you don't mind filling that out, that just lets us know that you're here. Give it to one of the staff members, and we have a special gift for you. And if you're watching online, drop us a comment. Let us know that you're here. Again, we have a special gift for you as well. If we would at this time, if the ushers would come forward, and we are going to give God his tithe and his love offerings. And as they're coming forward, if you would join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for bringing us here, God, and we thank you that the lessons and the reason that we gathered last week on Easter, that continues over into today. God, we thank you again just for allowing us to join here as a group, God. God, be with the service as we continue to worship. Be with the offering as it is given. Use this in ways that we can't even understand. Multiply this, God. Bless the gift and the giver. We love you and we thank you. In your name, amen.
As we give our tithes and offerings together today, let me tell you a couple things you need to know about here at Grace Church. Are you interested in going to church camp this summer? If so, make sure to send camp to the number below and get links sent to you with children's and youth camp forms. Church camp is awesome. I'll be there, and I hope you will be too.
Morning, Grace Church. This is Randy bringing you an update on our Pick a Project initiative. Thank you very much for all the folks who have helped out. On the very first day of this, we had 27 items, 18 of them were picked up, and 7 of them are already completed. So that's a fantastic start to this. I appreciate everybody who's done work out here. Jacob, Warren, let's see. We've had projects finished by Carolyn, Stephanie. Thank you for everything you guys have already done. And for those who have picked projects that haven't started, I just want you to know, we don't want anybody to be thinking that they're going to be incurring costs for this. Everything we have on here will be covered in it. So just if you pick up a project, know that it isn't going to be anything that you'll have to pay for yourself. I'd just like to have everybody think that in the future, this is something that we'd like to do ongoing. As we remove a couple projects off the list, we're going to be adding others. If we could all pitch in a couple hours a month, we'll always have this stuff covered. So appreciate your involvement. Just for our lesson today, Colossians 3:23, scripture for you. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. Thank you, folks.
Wow, the Grace Church Choir did such a great job for Easter as we worshiped our wonderful God. Thank you, choir. During the months of the summer, Pastor Sean is planning to have the choir sing once a month. We hope you will join us. We need new choir members to add to our choir, and we want to welcome them. Y'all are such a blessing. Thank you for all you do. I'm excited about the choir.
Starting this June, we have a cool opportunity coming up as a church. The YMCA is going to be using our gym and parts of our building throughout the summer to host a summer camp for children. You know what this means? It means the community is going to be coming in the doors of our church. It means we have a chance to reach out to kids and families in our area. And this is a great opportunity indeed. I would like to invite all of you that are interested, or all of you that are willing, to come talk to me today. What I want to do is, instead of just opening our building to them, I want to open up our church and engage them in the name of Jesus. We're going to need help to do that. We're going to need help with things like, well, leading the weekly Bible study we get to do with them. That's an hour a week. If you can't do an hour a week, that's okay. There's other things you can do. I'd like to serve coffee to parents on maybe one morning a week. I'd like to make a craft or a gift, a little something we can send home with the kids maybe once a month. There's all kinds of opportunities and options. And sometimes I may just need some help dreaming up ideas. I need you. We need to do this as a church, to rally around this camp and this possibility together to reach into our community in a new way. So please, come talk to me.
Keep checking our texting service. We're using social media to stay up to date on all that's happening. You'll see some of the things I've talked about, as well as the other things like these.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church Universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
What a wonderful privilege to be a child of God.
You unravel me with a melody. Surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to
much time running around and not enough time stopped in the presence of God. And this is our moment to come together corporately to do just that. So I invite you, come. Lord, thank you for this day, for the breath of life that fills our lungs, for the joint breath we breathe out in praise to you. Join us closer today in your community, surrounded by your presence. Lord, as we gather here, it is not an empty routine, but Lord, it is a celebration that the tomb is empty, that you move forward, and that your grace is for all of us. Empower us, shape us, and move us through today. Let everything we do, from the prayer we share in now to the sermon to come, be something we participate in together with every intention of building the kingdom both in our hearts and our world around us. Lord, we lift up today the many needs represented and connected to this church, those that are sick, those that are hurting, those that are struggling, and those that have big things coming up this week. And we just say thank you that you are a God who's big enough for every one of those things. But also, Lord, make your presence known in a new way today. Increase our faith and increase our love. Be with those that are in mission around the world, and the missionaries and the churches. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And today, help us wholly take part in the goodness of who you are, because we are no longer slaves to fear. We are your children. This day we pray and say thank you. Amen. Today we have the joy of not just going through regular service, but also having some special guests with us. So at this time, I'd like to welcome the Gideons representatives up here to share the word of the Lord with us.
Good morning. You know, the Apostle Paul wrote that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So that's a wonderful song. Jesus one time said, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." And it's really a unique statement, because he didn't say — it's actually in English a definitive article. He didn't say you will know a truth, but he said you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Another time he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." Again, definitive articles. He was saying that there are other truths, there are other ways, and there's other forms of life, but there is only one definitive way, one definitive truth, and one way to live and order your life. See, we live in an age where people say that all things are relative, that there's many shades of gray, but the Bible doesn't teach that. These thoughts have crept even into the church in recent years, but it's just not true. There is a way that a man, a woman, and even children, that we can order our lives, and is found in the Holy Scriptures. And so we, in fact, Albert Einstein, to whom we attribute discovering the theory of relativity, he said within his lifetime, people started to use the expression, "Well, you know, it's all relative," you know, in the context of social problems or in the context of right and wrong. But he said, no, relativity is only true as it pertains to time, space, and matter. It has nothing whatsoever to do with right and wrong, with ethics and morals. In other words, that there is a way that we should be able to order our life, and it can't simply be up to the opinion of individuals in every culture, creed, and tongue and generation. In fact, in the book of Judges, it concludes with these words, "And every man did what was right in his own eyes, for there was no king in the land." And you see, the Lord Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And he says that, "I have a will for your life." And if you choose to yield your will to my will, you see, there's not just one will at work in the universe. There's always three wills at work in the affairs of men. There's God's will, which we speak of oftenly and reverently, as we should. But there's also the will of the individual. And Satan has a will for your life too, and I promise you it's not good. In fact, Jesus said in John 10:10, he said, Satan, he called him the thief. He said, he's the one who steals, kills, and destroys. He said, Jesus went on to say, but I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly. See, there's that contrast between Satan's evil, his will, and God's will. Lest we sometimes forget in the church today that it's not just God's will that's the issue here. How about your will? We have the exhortation in every single book of the Bible, 39 in the Old, 27 in the New, 66 books total in the Word of God, in your Bible. And the exhortation is found over and over again for you to make a decision. Who are you going to align your life with? And that's why as Gideon's an auxiliary, the ladies are called the auxiliary, we go around the world. Right now we distribute God's holy word in 200 different countries in 109 different languages because we believe it is God's definitive, his absolute word. Not just the letter of it, but the spirit of it, because God breathed his word in the writers. It was not written by man. The word of God even explains in the book of Hebrews how he breathed and he spoke through the prophets and holy men. And he said, write this down. And hence we have the Bible today. And there's no mistakes in it. In fact, sometimes if you run into someone who says, well, there's all these mistakes in the Bible, give them your Bible and say, show me one. You know, God's word is truth and we can order our life. Erin Teeley was a mother in Pensacola, Florida. And she went to a hotel, but she didn't go there for the same reasons that you and I would go there. She went there to die. She intended to commit suicide, a mother of four children. In fact, with a nursing one-year-old baby in her arms, she went there to take her life. She walked into that hotel room, and she looked around, and she saw a Bible, a Bible that was placed by the Gideons there some time ago. And just she was drawn to that book and she started opening it. And she opened, the first verse that she found was Isaiah 59, verses 1 and 2. And it speaks there how her sins have separated her from God. You see, sin separates then as today. If we were to go back in time all the way to the garden, when Adam and Eve partook of the forbidden fruit, that disobedience separated not just man from God, but it separated them from each other. There was discord, enmity between the woman and Satan and between the man and his wife and with God. That sin always brings discord and division. And during the course of the evening, she wrote us a letter, sent it to Nashville, Tennessee, the headquarters of Gideon's International. And she said Satan had convinced her that her enemy was her husband, and they were at war for years. But she come to find out after spending all night, literally all through the night, she didn't sleep one wink. She said the Spirit of God directed her, Old Testament, New Testament, and he showed her during those hours all through the night that God is love and God is good, but Satan is evil and wicked, and he wants to put men in chains and slavery. You could read that in your Bible in Mark chapter 5, the demoniac, the Gadarene. He was in chains for years, and all men did for him was forge more chains when he would break them. But when Jesus came on the scene, the chains were broken, and he was set free, even as he had said that he would bring the truth, and his truth would set men free. Amen? And so Erin Teeley discovered that Satan was the one that had forged those chains in her relationship with her family. And she repented of her sin. In fact, she saw the sun come up through the curtains in that hotel room. And when she opened she realized that she had been praying and studying the Word of God all through the night. She found a phone book and called a local pastor and told him what she had contemplated doing and how Christ had revealed his love and his life to her. And she then received Christ. And today, this woman who had intended to take her life, and consequently that nursing baby, Today, her and her husband, they have a beautiful ministry all around America today. Amen. See? Satan is the one who steals, kills, and destroys. When you buy a newspaper today, or you hear the news, and you hear about shootings and murder and abortion and all the wicked things that go on in life, that's not God. That's Satan who steals, kills, and destroys. And so we distribute God's holy word to bring that light, that truth, to show that the word of God is there to expose the wicked, darkness, things that go on in the world. Not to condemn humanity, but so that humanity can be free. Just like the demoniac became free of those chains. Jesus wants us to be free from all these unseen chains. Some of you maybe have some of those unseen chains today. And Jesus has the power, the authority in the letter and the spirit of his word to set you free as well. If you go out into the foyer, you'll see a display rack. You'll see these little cards. You can give Bibles in memory or in recognition of hopefully someone, if they pass away, hopefully with Jesus, or in recognition for a joyful event like a graduation or a marriage. You all received an insert today in your bulletin. Should you choose to support this ministry, the full-size Bible that Erin Teeley found in her room, it costs $5 to place and distribute a Bible like that somewhere around the world in one of these other 199 countries in the world. We receive testimonies all the time of lives that were changed, not just people intending to take their life. There was a man in the Central African Republic in Bangui. He went to a hotel room in a remote village because he knew that the Gideons had placed Bibles in the major city of Berberati. So he went to this little village a few miles away to commit adultery with a woman that was not his wife. He walked into that hotel room and he saw that Bible laying on the nightstand. And he never walked in the room. He said, "I gotta go." And he left that woman and he didn't see her again. A month later, he went home to Berberati. A month later, he heard that the woman that he had intended to commit adultery with had died from AIDS. You see, he said the Gideon Bible saved his life and that of his wife. And the fear of God came on him, and he realized the plight that he was in, the peril that he could have been in. So he repented, received Jesus as Savior and Lord, and he's actually a Gideon in Africa today. Praise God. You see, Satan is the one who steals, kills, and destroys. He's the one that brings darkness. In fact, the Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 5 to us, to the church of Ephesus, he said, "Do not participate in the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them." So this is the forbidden fruit for you and I today, to not participate in all the wicked things that are going on in the world. In fact, we can't stop short there. He says it's our responsibility to expose them, to reprove them, and resist them. Even as it says in the book of James, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. You see, if you're not submitted to God, you can't resist the devil. You don't have the power. And so we need to be under his authority, submitting our lives to God, a living sacrifice. We resist the devil, and Satan is obligated to flee. Amen? So should the Lord speak to you today, you could give, if, for example, if you wanted to give to the Gideons. By the way, all the money is used to place and distribute his word. My wife and I and all the others, we're volunteers. We don't get a dime. Our reward, hopefully, is somewhere in the future, but it won't be in this life, I promise. But these little testaments that we give out to our students, the youth, all around the world, it costs $1.30 to place one of these testaments. The full-size Bible that Erin Teeley saw and ministered to, it costs $5 to place and distribute. So, should the Lord speak to you today, you can make out your checks just to write a check out to the Gideons, and however amount that amount is, and you could place it in the offering plate as we dismiss later today. Or again, you can, if you don't have the funds with you today, just take this envelope in your insert. You don't have to fill out anything. Just put the money in there and a stamp and put it in mail. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for your life, that we are no longer slaves, but that we are free, just as you said, and you promised that your truths would set us free. I thank you for every life that is here. May we take another look at your book and realize, Lord God, that these words are truth and there's no mistakes found therein. That we would, in fact, that David said, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Give us a renewed love for thee, Lord God. Help us to love you more and serve you better. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for that. As the ushers come at this time, I wanted to let you know this is a time for us to give a special offering to the Gideons because his word does not return void. Amen. And so we have a chance to be a participant in the building of the kingdom of God. So at this time, please, as ushers come, feel free to give any money you might wish to. It goes directly to the Gideons and auxiliaries to give the word of the Lord around the world. If you don't get a chance to do it right now, feel free. Again, there's the envelope and there's a chance, there's boxes at the back, and you can meet them out in the foyer. There's lots of ways to give, so please give and give generously. Today we have a special speaker, and luckily for you, it's not me. You're welcome. But today we get to welcome to the stage someone that's grown up here, someone that we love very much. Will you please welcome James Hughes?
Just a moment. And say what a amazing group of young people we have in our church, right? Absolutely. Give them some recognition, right? So from the very youngest who are in the nursery all the way up to the seniors in high school, we have a great group of young people. A couple weeks ago, our teens went on a trip called TNT, right? And I'll explain what TNT is here in just a moment. But it was a blast, right? We got to spend like 3 days running around nonstop. We got to hang out together as a group. We got to hang out with other churches. The other groups hung out with us too. We had the most random conversations that you could ever imagine. Like, are there more wheels in the world or are there more windows, right? Which is a fun conversation. I encourage you to have it. The teen guys, we came up with a new mascot. We named him Coke Bear. Talk to the teen guys for that if you want more information on Coke Bear. But what exactly is TNT, right? So TNT stands for Top Nazarene Talent. And all over the Southeast region, the teens from Kentucky, the Carolinas, Florida, Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, Mississippi, they come together in a time of competition, right? But the overall theme for TNT was from God, for God, and in the service of others. And so that basically means that we have all been given gifts and talents, and we're supposed to use those to further God's kingdom and to serve others. But that's a conversation and a sermon for a different day. And I'll say our group represented us extremely well, both in the awards category, but also in the sportsmanship category as well. All right, we had, after the first day, like the teams that our kids were on, they went something like 15-1 in all their different competitions, which is phenomenal. At the end of the event, they ended up winning first and second in flag football, third in men's soccer, fourth in women's soccer, fourth in beach volleyball, first in dodgeball, first in golf. And then we also had a couple do things like submit art projects, poetry, and then we even had one teen do a sermon. So at this point, I would like to invite Edita to come up to the stage. Let's give her some encouragement. So Edita is going to present us with the sermon that she presented at TNT. So Edita, here you go.
Thank you. Sorry. Good morning, Grace Church.
Good morning.
So My title for this sermon is Be Still and Know That I'm God. I'm going to be reading in Psalms 46:10, but my main story is going to be in Matthew 14, verses 22 to 33. It says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will exalt among the nations. I will exalt in the earth." And the story that I'll be reading is Jesus walking on water. It says, "Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed the crowd, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat by this time was long ways from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, 'It is a ghost,' and they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on water.' And he said, 'Come.' So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink. And he cried out, 'Lord, save me.' Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying, 'Oh, you with little faith, why did you doubt?' And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshiped him saying, 'Truly you are the Son of God.'" They started worshiping God and saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." They realized who was before him, who was before them, and it was Jesus. And I can only imagine how Peter was feeling, you know, as he was the only one that was willing to step out into the great unknown, to step out into the sea while there was a big storm, while the other disciples, I can imagine them grabbing onto something, just holding in the boat, and were just terrified. But Peter said to Jesus, "If it is truly you, ask me to come." And as Peter was walking out, as he was looking at Jesus, he was walking on the water. But then as soon as he looked from Christ, as soon as he took his eyes from Jesus, he started sinking. But the most interesting part of this story, he didn't call out to the 11 disciples that were in the boat that were more than capable of getting a rope and getting him out. But he cried out to his Lord and said, "Lord, save me." And Jesus immediately reached out his hand and pulled him out. And as Peter was getting out, Jesus said, why did you doubt me?" Because not too long ago, they just saw Jesus feed 5,000. This miracle that is spoke about even today, not including the women and children. He fed a multitude in front of the disciples, and they saw how Jesus just spoke and how his words was so much, how his word was so powerful. And then I started thinking about my life and thinking about those times when I doubted God, and when God had called me out from the great unknown, when God has called me out into the sea, the moments where it looks like I won't survive. And I'm clinging on to the boat and saying, "God, if it's truly you, please say come." And as God is calling me out and saying, "Come, come," I'm afraid. God called me into ministry when I was a young girl, and I was so confused. I was like, "God, I don't know why you would want me to do this. First of all, I suck at talking to people. I hate reading, and I do not want to do it." But God continued to press in my heart, "I want you to preach. I want you to share the gospel." And I was just, I knew it was the Lord. I knew it was the work of the Holy Spirit, but I was just struck with fear. I was just like the disciples. God was calling me to a place of stillness, but I was struck by fear and anxiety. And I was just like, "God, I just don't know."
But then when I did step out, and I stepped out and I was like, okay, God, let it be your will, not mine. And then I stepped out into the boat, out of the boat, and I saw the wind. I saw the enemy came and attacked me through various points of my life, and even critical moments of my life where I knew God was calling me and leading me to do something, and I just didn't know. I didn't want to go there, and the enemy would put thoughts in my head, and I was just struck by fear. But God truly grabbed my heart that day when he called me into ministry. And just as Peter, I walked out, and it was going great. I was looking at Christ, and then I started looking at my circumstances. I started looking at the storm. I started focusing on the storm, and I began to sink. But contrary to Peter, I started calling out for other people. I started putting my identity in other people, and I started just wrapping my life with sports and other friendships. And I was just so, and I would get manipulated by friends and all these different things that happened to me. But this year, when the pandemic hit, God called me to a place of stillness like I've never experienced in my life. There was no one to turn to. There was nowhere you could go. I mean, you were just in a moment of stillness. And God gave me this word that says, be still and know that I am God. Just in the knowing of God, that you can become still with God. And in his presence, you can start, just venting and just saying, God, I need you in this area. And just, and then that's when I signed up for preaching, and I gave this word, and I did not know where God was going to go with this word. I won second place at Momentum, and then I went to TNT, and I'm just like, the best I would do is third place. And then God was like, nope, you're going second. And I was just like, oh my God, thank you, Jesus. But I just wanted to say this, like, if you're going through a storm, I've been there. If you're sinking because you have placed your eyes at your storm and you're sinking, remember that you have a God that you can call upon and say, Christ, Jesus, I need you. I need you in this moment. And God will quickly be there to reach his hand and get you out of that storm. Remember that you are not alone. Remember that you have brothers and sisters that are here at Grace Church that is willing to help you go through that storm and that period in your life where God is directing you into a certain place in your life and where God wants you to go. Just remember to answer the call and remember to look at Christ. And then after the disciples, after they witnessed all this, they worshiped God. Remember that Jesus is truly the Son of God. The tomb is empty, and we are saved through the blood and the finished work of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Before I finish, I would like to end with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this word. Thank you, Father God, for loving me and placing this call upon my life, Lord. Lord, I give all of me to you, Jesus. And I just pray for anyone in this room, Father, that is just in a place in their life where they're just in a storm. And they have turned their face from you, Jesus, and now they're sinking. Help them remember that they have a Heavenly Father that is there to get them out of that storm and to protect them and to guide them in the midst of their storm. And I just pray for the Grace Church, Lord, for your will as we're looking for a new pastor, Lord, that even when it looks like all these pastors are like passing us up and there's no one coming, but let us remember that you are the God that sees all and that knows all and is here today. I'm grateful and so thankful for everything that you're doing in our lives. I pray, Father God, that you continue to walk with us, continue to guide us, protect us. In your precious name, Jesus, amen.
We could almost end on that note, right? But I only get to do this every now and then, so we're going to keep going. So, no, awesome job, Edita. It has been a pleasure to watch Edita in her relationship with Christ, to watch her grow, to her accept and really lean into this call of ministry that God has placed on your life. And I hate that you're leaving, Edita. I hate it, but I'm looking forward to when you come back and you tell us stories about what God has done in and through your life and how he is taking your ministry and blessing it in ways that you don't even understand or can't even imagine right now. So awesome job, Edita. So we talked about the teens for a little bit. So we can't leave out the kids, right? The kids are just as important. The kids have been busy as well. A couple Saturdays ago, we had our Easter event, and the weather forced us to go Plan B on short notice, but we still had a great time hunting for Easter eggs, doing crafts, playing games. But most importantly, we had the opportunity to share the real meaning of Easter with kids. And of course, that is the resurrection of Jesus. And so we had the opportunity to do that. But on Sunday mornings, the kids, we've also been talking about the story of Moses. And we've been taking each of like the main events in Moses' life, and we've been talking about them. And something that's been placed on my heart here recently is application, right? You take a story, you learn about the story, but how do you apply it to your life, right? And if we leave out that application part of it, then there's really no point of us learning the stories. The stories are just that, they're just stories. So we have been putting a special emphasis on the stories of Moses. And so today, I would like for you to turn with me to Exodus chapter 3. And as you turn, I'm going to give you some background on the story that we're going to be talking about today. It's a pretty common story. You've probably heard it before. It's actually probably one of the most common stories in all of the Bible. So Moses, he has fled from Egypt. He has just killed the Egyptian. And so he is running away, and he finds himself in the little podunk spot of Midian, right? In the middle of no place. And so it is here in Midian that he becomes a shepherd. He gets married, has a family. And to say that his life is completely different than the life that he lived in Egypt is a complete understatement. And so one day, Moses takes his father-in-law's flocks of sheep, and he goes to what is now known as Mount Sinai. And so while he's there, he sees something that catches his eye, something that he's never seen before. He sees a bush that's on fire, but yet the bush is not being consumed by the flames. And so Moses, in typical guy fashion, he sees this and he's like, I've got to get closer. Right? Like, let me see what this is all about. So as he is approaching this burning bush, he hears a voice. And it's not just like someone yelling his name. No, the voice is coming from the bush itself and saying, Moses, Moses. It's calling him by name. Spoiler alert, that voice is God. So Moses and God now presume to have a conversation together. And so this is where we pick up the story. God has just told Moses that he is going to go back to Egypt and that he is going to lead the Israelite slaves out of Egypt, out of captivity, and take them to the promised land. So if you would look at verse 11. Verse 11 says, But Moses protested to God, Who am I to appear before Pharaoh? Who am I to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt? And so God responds in verse 12. God says, I will be with you. So Moses, he keeps questioning, right? He doesn't just take it at that. He keeps questioning. And that takes us all the way through to chapter 4, right? It's a lot of questions. So we're in chapter 4. We're looking at verse 10 now. Moses still questioning. He says, Oh Lord, I'm not very good with words. I never have been, and I'm not now. Even though you have spoken to me, I get tongue-tied and my words get tangled. Anybody want to take a guess at what God's response was? God says, Who makes a person's mouth? Who decides whether people speak or do not speak, hear or do not hear? see or do not see? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will be with you as you speak, and I will instruct you in what to say. So there's a theme starting to develop here in God's responses, right? He says, I will be with you. Again, Moses doesn't like that answer. He again says, Lord, please send anyone else. Please send someone else. God, I can imagine, is getting a little frustrated with Moses. He's like, fine, you got an older brother. You know, you can take Aaron. He can be your plus one. And so he says, I will be with both of you as you speak, and I will instruct you both in what to do. So we'll end the story here, right? Even though this is just the beginning of the really good part of the story of Moses. So we've talked about the story, right? So now here comes the part of application. And this is what I love about doing this upstairs with the kids, because I ask the kids, hey, what stood out to you, right? What's one thing that you can learn from the story? And the answers that I get are phenomenal, right? And it's stuff that I wouldn't even consider. So what stands out to me is not what stands out to you. What stands out to you is not going to stand out to me. So hopefully you talk about the service at lunch, right? So as you talk about, hey, what did Moses, or what did what stood out to you from this sermon, right? You can have it, engage in a conversation, and you might be able to learn something. Even though this is a pretty common story, you might look at it in a different perspective. But for me, right, three things stood out to me. The first one is that you can never run from God. Now, that's not to say that Moses was actually running from God, right? He was actually more running from his past and his past mistakes. But Moses wanted to get to a place where nobody knew who he was or what he had done. But the thing is, God knew exactly where Moses was. He knew that Moses was going to be taking those flocks to Mount Sinai. He knew where he was going to be to appear in this bush. God knew where Moses was, even though he was trying to hide. And this is not a new idea, right? We see this in other stories of the Bible too, right? We see it in the story of Jonah, right? Where this guy is running from God and he ends up in the belly of a whale or a big fish. And it is in this belly that he repents and he asks God for forgiveness. And even though he's in the belly of a fish in the bottom of the ocean, God still heard him. God knew where he was. Right, we go New Testament, right? Paul and Silas, they found themselves in jail. They were in the innermost part of a dungeon. We've talked about the innermost part of the dungeon before. It's the dark, dank place that you don't want to be. Right? It's a hole in the ground. No light can get in. But God knew where they were. God heard their prayer. He heard their songs of praise. He heard their hymns. And God heard them and saw them and knew where they were. There is no place that we can go where God cannot hear or cannot see us. So a second thing that stood out to me from this story is that God can use anybody. Now, that's not to say that Moses wasn't special, because he was. He was a special guy. He grew up as a prince of Egypt. He had the best education. He was being trained to be a future leader. But I think what's important, when God appeared to Moses, Moses was a nobody. He didn't even have his own sheep, right? He was shepherding his father-in-law's flocks. Moses was essentially a fugitive wanted for murder. And again, this is not the only time that we see God using people that we wouldn't normally think of, right? We have the story of Gideon, who was the weakest of his clan, who was the clan was the weakest in all of the area, right? But God was able to use him to defeat the Midianites and to save Israel. We have the story of David and Goliath, who God uses this itty-bitty little guy in David to defeat this big bad war machine in Goliath when all the odds were stacked up against him. There's a quote from Mark Batterson that you've probably all heard before. It says, God does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. When God wants us to do something, it might be out of our comfort zone, and it probably will be out of our comfort zone. But this is the important part. When he calls us to do it, he's not going to give us a pat on the backside and a good luck, buddy, and let me know how it goes. It's not how God works. God is going to go before you into that situation. God will be with you as you walk in that situation. You're not going in it alone. God will give you everything that you need to fulfill the call that he has placed on your life. And the last thing that stood out to me from this story was the actual conversation that Moses had with God. God told Moses to go to Egypt. Moses didn't just say, no, I don't want to go. He told God that God was wrong and God had made a mistake and he had chose the wrong person. Like, really, Moses? How dare you question what God said, right? We would never do anything like that in today's world, would we? No. In case you didn't get that, that is sarcasm, right? Have we been there before? Have we told God that he was wrong in choosing us? That God didn't know what he was doing? I know I personally have. I know I haven't felt up to the standard that God has wanted me to do and the things that he wanted me to do. But what's important from this conversation that Moses had with God is that Moses eventually gave in, right? And that's a bad way to say it. It makes it sound worse than it was. But essentially what happened, he gave up his own selfish desires and his selfish wants. He put himself off to the side to do what God wanted him to do. He did go back to Egypt. He did go face to face with Pharaoh. He was the voice piece or in the mouthpiece for God to the Israelites and to the Egyptians. And he would eventually lead all the people out of Egypt. So I ask you, what stood out to you from this story? This story that we've probably heard a bunch of times. All right, what is something that you're going to try to take and apply to your own personal life? Maybe you find yourself running from God, or you find yourself running from your past and a past mistake that you've made. Maybe we're afraid to face the people that we've let down or to face the people that we've hurt. But here's the truth. God knows what we did. He knows where we're at. He knows where we are going. And that has never stopped him, and it will never stop him from loving us or being with us and drawing close to us if we ask him. Right? Maybe you don't feel qualified to do the work that God has called you to do. Here's the truth. God is going with you. You're not alone. Again, if he has called you to do something, he wants you to do it. And he will make sure that that path is there and will direct you along that path. All right, maybe we find ourselves trying to figure out what it is God wants us to do. We're looking for that burning bush moment, that moment of clarity when everything clicks. Well, here's the truth. If you're out looking for a burning bush to tell you what to do, you're probably not going to find it. And if you do find it, please call me because I want to check it out too. But instead of going out looking for that burning bush, lean into the things that God has already given us. Lean into the Word, the Bible, that is full of his wisdom and his promises. Spend time with God. Tell him about your burdens. Tell him about your needs. Tell him what's on your heart and what's on your mind. But also listen. Sit in silence. I know it's hard, but sit in silence and listen to God. In James chapter 4, verse 7, the first part of 8, it says, "So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come close to God and he will come close to you." It's in these moments that we lean into God, that we come close to God, that we can begin to hear, we can begin to understand what God wants us to do. We can begin to understand God's will for our life. Maybe you find yourself already knowing what God wants you to do, but you're hesitant to do it, or you're just downright resisting it. You're playing the game of tug of war with God. And I tell you, I've played that game, and it did not end well for me. Put the rope down. Surrender your end of the rope. Give in to God, and the amount of peace and the feeling of peace that you will experience, I can't even describe it. I can't even put it into words to describe it. It's not easy. It's not easy to give over that rope. It's not easy to put what you want off to the side. But in order to do God's will, we have to do that.